Good evening and welcome to December. The Brattleboro Select Board is next here on BCTV. This is Tim Johnson. Tonight, the board acting as liquor commissioners will deal with a special event permit at the Cotton Mill Open House expected for this weekend. Utility equipment bids will be on the board's agenda, as well as further discussion of the police fire facilities project, discussion about the proposed Elliott Street bridge repair, acceptance and appropriation of a Better Back Roads grant from the Vermont Agency of Transportation. Four separate items on the agenda for the GS Precision Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation proposal at the Exit 1 Industrial Park. And on page 3, which was here a moment ago, errors and omissions to the grand list, several solid waste matters, including discussion with Bob Spencer from the Wyndham Solid Waste District, ratifying the town manager's approval of emergency purchase of replacement compressor at the Nelson Withington Skating Rink, a grant application for the Vermont Community Foundation, acceptance of a drug interdiction grant, and several committee appointments. Brattleboro Select Board is next here on BCTV.
Good evening. It's December 1st, and we're here for our first regularly scheduled meeting of December of the Brattleboro Select Board. We know that the meeting's been officially warned because we convened at 5:30 and went into executive session to discuss contracts, real estate options, and collective bargaining related matters. No decisions were made during executive session. Thank you. The first item on tonight's agenda, welcome to everybody who's watching us on TV. Welcome to everybody who's in attendance. Welcome to our BCTV technicians, our ASL interpreters, and members of the press. First item on tonight's agenda is to approve minutes from November 10, November 17, and November 21. Do we have a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Yep.
We have a motion to approve minutes from those three dates. Is there any discussion or changes from anybody on the board? Any discussion, any changes from anybody who's in attendance? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0 with one of the members of the board being absent this evening. The next item on the agenda is chair's remarks. I guess my only remarks this evening are once again to thank everybody who came out and participated in our discussion yesterday about the police fire project. We actually have police fire on the agenda later on. But I want to announce that we are having our third meeting to discuss police fire facilities project alternatives tomorrow at 6 o'clock in the Brattleboro Area Middle School multi-purpose room. We want to invite everybody to attend and to share with us their ideas after hearing the current alternatives that are being presented and being considered for the police fire facilities project going forward. And please shop downtown and shop often.
Right. Not just downtown.
Shop in town and often. Thank you, Kate. Next matter on the agenda is town manager's comments.
Thank you. I have two this evening, one bit of good news and one bit of other news. So the good news is that the new grader has arrived just in time for winter. Actually was delivered today in the kind of sloppy weather that we had today. So when the snow flies, we'll be glad to have the grader here. And on a very serious note, as a advance notice to the community, there will be a lot of coverage, we hope, in the media about this in the days ahead to make sure that everybody's well aware of this in advance. But VTrans and PCL have announced that in order to do some necessary maintenance work on the existing old I-91 bridge over the West River, in preparation for winter, they're really at the last possible opportunity to patch some potholes out there and do some other remedial work that needs to be done to safe up the bridge for winter. There will be 1 week from today on Tuesday, December 8th, from 9 in the morning to 3 in the afternoon, complete closure of the southbound lanes of 91, so there will be a traffic impact throughout the community. And the following day, on Wednesday, December 9th, it will be exactly the same thing, 9 in the morning until 3 p.m., a complete shutdown of the northbound lanes so that they can do the work that's necessary. We've had a couple of days' notice of this prior to the public announcement of it. Police Department and others have been coordinating with VTrans, with the Sheriff's Office, who will be providing traffic control that day. We've got a plan to put all the traffic signals up and down Route 5 on flash that day to help the traffic keep moving slowly and steadily through town. So it'll be a great inconvenience on December 8th and 9th, but it is work that needs to be done in order to keep the elderly bridge safe for another winter. So.
The operative word is slowly moving through town.
Yes, sir.
You can shop.
Next matter on the agenda is select board comments and committee reports. Anybody on the board have any comments or committee reports? Okay. Next matter on the agenda would be public participation. Is there anybody here this evening who wants to speak to something that's not on the agenda?
Tim.
Mr. Johnson.
Mr. Sandy Claus.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick note about Project Feed the Thousands. The campaign is underway. Both non-perishable food items, personal care items, and cash donations are greatly appreciated, not only at this time of year, but year-round. And in fact, kudos to Brattleboro Town employees in advance of the December 11th holiday breakfast. The employees normally do a food drive for the event, and I know that it's greatly appreciated because they see the things that people on the front line see day by day, and to know that they care enough about their fellow human beings is extremely gratifying. So thank you. Please give what you can.
Thank you, Tim. Anybody else on the public participation? Well, then the next matter on the agenda is liquor commissioners. We're ready for motion to convene as liquor commissioners.
So moved.
All those in favor of convening as liquor commissioners, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. We have a request for a special event permit for Saxtons River Distillery for the Cotton Mill Open House. I don't see anybody here from Saxtons River Distillery, do I?
You don't. They were not required to be present. And I can report that everything is in order. They filed all the proper paperwork. The plans have been reviewed by the police department and the fire department, and we recommend your approval.
So this is for a special event permit on Friday, December 4, Saturday, December 5th, and Sunday, December 6th from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. each day in conjunction with the Cotton Mill Open Studio on holiday sale, where Saxtons River Distillery will be doing what?
They will be offering a tasting bar. They'll be offering small quantities for tasting at the event.
No more than 2 ounces per product, 8 ounces total.
Correct.
Any questions or comments from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? We're ready for motion, I would think.
I move that we approve a special event permit for Saxtons River Distillery to provide a tasting bar at Cotton Mill Studios, 74 Cotton Mill Hill, on Friday through Sunday, December 4th, 5, and 6, 2015, from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. each day in conjunction with this Cotton Mill Open Studio and Holiday Sale event.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And we oppose or abstaining. It carries 4-0. Is there any other business to come in front of us as liquor commissioners? Hearing none,
We're looking for a motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners, please.
So moved.
We have motion to adjourn as liquor commissioners. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. We're now ready for a motion to convene as water and sewer commissioners.
I move that we convene as water and sewer commissioners.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. Do we have anybody here from Utilities Division? Okay, Peter, please talk to us about buying some vehicles.
Thank you. Yes, there are five vehicles that we, four vehicles that we are recommending for award. In the fifth bid opening, we got a bid that was above our budget, and we believe we can do better with a rebid process. So four that we're recommending for approval, two of which are the low bid on these vehicles, all of which come in below our budgeted amount, so there isn't any case where there would be any supplemental funds required. But two of them have nuances to them that I want to briefly explain and ask for your approval on all four. So the first is the compact trailer, which is a recommendation for a low bid award to Salem Farm Supply of Salem, New York. We have $40,000 budgeted, and we're recommending $39,044 as the bid award. Then there were three bids received for a service truck with warranties. In this case, the low bid was bid a 2015 model, and it did not meet all of our specifications. The 2016 model that was bid by Shearer Chevrolet of South Burlington did meet all of our specifications, and so it's only $758 higher than the low bid, and it's a better vehicle. Met all of our bid requirements, so we recommend the award of that purchase to Shearer Chevrolet of South Burlington for $43,298. The Bobcat Toolcat work machine, we're recommending a low bid award for $55,604. There were $60,000 budgeted for this item to Bobcat of Greater Springfield of West Springfield, Massachusetts. And finally, we recommend an award to DeLorey Sales for Viking equipment on a dump truck. DeLorey is from Hoosick Falls, New York. Their bid is $100,590, and it is about $3,000 higher than the overall low bid for this equipment. But in this particular case, there's a complicated set of warranties that come with this vehicle and with the equipment that is packaged on the vehicle. The apples-to-apples comparison of the DeLorey bid and the Patriot bid for Patriot Freightliner, that was the actual low bid for straight dollar amount, the apples-to-apples comparison actually falls to DeLorey as low bid by a little less than $1,000. But there's an additional warranty that DeLorey offered that Patriot did not, that we think the town should obtain based on the lifelines of these equipment and these vehicles and how important they are to our overall utility operation. So we can get a 7-year, 100,000-mile chassis warranty for the additional cost that takes the DeLorey overall price to the $100,590. And that is our recommendation for that particular purchase.
We've actually bought a lot of vehicles, I think, from DeLorey over in Hoosick Falls, I believe.
Maybe the case.
To the past years.
And we're also $10,000 under budget, it looks like.
Right.
And we are $10,000. Yeah, that's an important point. So even at the $100,590 with the additional warranty, we're coming in at $9,410 under budget.
Yep. Can I ask something as someone who knows nothing about dump trucks? They each put in two bids where they, you know, they have two, are these two different trucks? Like, why did they do that?
It's because of the equipment package.
Right. Okay.
It's the same truck, yeah, but with a different equipment package on the truck.
Okay.
Right.
And then we also
bid out. Why didn't we just ask for one? I don't get why we're, I don't mean to be stupid.
No,
you're not stupid. I can't answer the question directly, so we can get an answer to you from Steve or Hannah.
Okay.
The reason why there is some flexibility built into this, mm-hmm, is so that if an adequate package came in at a far lower price, we could seize that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know specifically why it's Viking equipment and HP Fairfield equipment that were the ones that were
right.
Specced.
Well, because they each because HP Fairfield or Patriot in
yes.
Delury both bid.
They were asked. They were asked to each bid the separate packages to go on the truck.
I mean, now I get it.
Yeah.
I get what you mean. Okay.
We now should also. You're all set?
Yeah. I'm sorry. That was stupid.
No, it's a good question.
We also should note that we solicited bids for a 12-ton tag along trailer, only got one bid, and it was well above the amount budgeted.
Correct.
And so that item is going back out to bid, and we're not going to be making that award tonight.
Correct.
Any other questions or comments from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? I move to approve the award of bids and authorize the town manager to proceed with the following. Purchase of a compact trailer with options from Salem Farm Supply of Salem, New York in the amount of $39,044. To purchase a service truck with warranties from Shearer Chevrolet of South Burlington, Vermont in the amount of $43,498. To purchase an international dump truck with Viking equipment package from Delory Sales of Hoosick Falls, New York for $100,590. And to purchase a Bobcat Toolcat work machine from Bobcat of Greater Springfield of West Springfield, Massachusetts for $55,604. Is there any further discussion?
No, but ASL interpreters appreciated that.
I know, I was reading fast.
Yeah, you were.
I was watching out the corner of my eye. Any other discussion?
I thought their hands were going to fall off.
Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. Is there any other business to come in front of Water and Sewer Commissioners? Hearing none, we're ready for a motion to adjourn as Water and Sewer Commissioners.
Move we adjourn as Water and Sewer Commissioners.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. Under unfinished business, police fire facilities project is on the agenda tonight, like it's going to be on the agenda going forward pretty consistently.
I'm wondering if anybody's got any thoughts or comments about what we saw and heard last night that want to talk about in public.
I'll just say that I'm pleasantly surprised that everybody is, very few people have come in knowing exactly what they think we should do, which I actually appreciate because that means people are taking the time to listen and look at the presentations and actually, even after the presentation, still not know what they want to do, which I think is a healthy way to approach this as opposed to everybody's stuck in a mode and not willing to really think about it. So, and that's happened at the first meeting, too. So that's what I've appreciated.
What I found that both meetings were almost identical. I mean, there was almost the same amount of people, and I took notes on and almost the same amount of questions, and they were pretty close. The one that struck me the most was about, it tugs at your heartstrings a little bit, and I thought that was kind of a unique question by a couple people, and I just wanted out there that you really have to vote on your own conscience. It comes down to that, whether it's a person. I don't think there's anybody out there that doesn't appreciate the police or fire department. So I don't think it has anything to do with that. So it really does come down to, we all know that it's going to, it's going to be pennies on the dollar, and it's going to hurt to some degree. But, so it is no reflection on, on our departments. So it's, and I think that was taken to heart a little bit last night. So
I think agree with that. I think there was a really clear clear representation of the support for the police and fire services that we have. And the only thing I had, and I spoke with Peter about this, that because we're going to be building new facilities and refitting old facilities in more efficient ways, there will be savings over the 20 years of this bond. And I wanted to get that that financial information into the public presentations as soon as we possibly can. Some of it is estimates, but some of it we can know pretty well. So that's my only addition or comment.
I would note that it's been clear for a very long time that how to proceed with the police fire project requires us to balance the health and safety needs of people in town, generational needs to bring the facilities up to date and to serve us for the next 20 or 25 years, but also the burden that taxpayers feel through increased taxes. And I do have to agree that a vote based upon finances should not be seen as a vote that devalues the police and fire services and personnel and facilities because there's substantial tax burden and those are competing interests that need to be considered and need to be weighed, and there's no good answer to it. There are people who communicate their support in terms of the needs of those departments, and then people who raise concerns about the costs don't want to be seen as devaluing those departments, and I think we need to be careful about that. I would also note, just procedurally, we've had a number of thoughts about how we might proceed forward, and I thought I would at least begin by floating some of those ideas now so that we can begin thinking about them in terms of timing. One of the issues that's arisen at the meetings has been whether we should be going directly to town meeting or whether we should be seeking some sort of public referendum before town meeting votes. And it is clear that the binding vote in the first instance can only be taken by town meeting.
Right.
We can't submit the bond question directly to the voters in the first instance. And so if we're going to be seeking public input by way of a vote, it may need to be similar to the non-binding vote that we had either in 2014 or 13 before town meeting. I think it was in 2014.
Was it?
May have been 13, about the 1% local option sales tax.
Oh, right.
And everybody will recall that we put the 1% local option sales tax on the March town meeting day election ballot, and the voters townwide overwhelmingly approved the 1% local option sales tax, and then town meeting overwhelmingly rejected it. But at least we had gotten the public sentiment from the voters at large. And it may be something to consider to put some sort of an item or items on that March 1st ballot. March 1st is election day and town meeting day this year. On that March 1st ballot, asking, for example, whether the voters think that we should issue, let's say, $7.7 million worth of bonds in order to complete the financing for the project involving rebuilding the facilities and moving the police department up to Putty Road. If that were to be the alternative, we can consider a number of alternatives as well. And then we may want to consider having our town meeting immediately thereafter, like a week before our March 19 regular town meeting. We consider having the police fire meeting on like March 12th in order to make a decision about the bonding related issue, and then go to town meeting on the 19th, knowing what that decision is and being able to incorporate that into the budget as a whole. So that's one potential path forward that I've been considering. We need 30 to 40 days before town meeting or town meeting election in order to notice it. So if, for example, we were going to be having a non-binding vote on March 1st, we have to have the warning go out between the 20th and 30th of January. And then we have similar deadlines going forward for any town meeting going forward.
How do we know what option to put down on a non-binding vote?
That's going to be the question we're going to decide after these informational meetings, for
right.
sure.
I mean, that's
the big question.
And we could consider multiple options to be warned for either a non-binding or a binding vote, but we can't change the warning.
Right.
Once it goes out 30 to 40 days before the meeting and the election. So those are some of the things we'll want to consider over the course of the next weeks, if we can get to a point where we can warn this for election, if we decide to go that way, and warn this for town meeting. Remember the dates, March 1 is election day, and March 19 is town meeting day.
Okay, so we're now thinking that we're going to go that route instead of having an earlier voting.
Well, we haven't thought it. We haven't talked about it.
Okay.
I'm presenting an idea for the first time today that gives us a little bit of time with a little bit of a path that would allow us to have a vote at a general election to try to get as many people voting if we decide to go that route as possible. Because having a special election, like in the middle of February, it'd be very difficult to get people
into
vote.
It's costly.
And it also, you wouldn't get people out.
Right.
I don't think there's any damage in having that vote on the 1st and still having the money in our budget for the 12th. Anyway, expecting that it's going to pass, and that's going to be a recommendation anyway, and the town will still have to vote on it. It's not going to be a binding election anyway, but we could get a sentiment which we could take with us to town meeting.
And we can do multiple items on the ballot too. We'll just have to consider that. So that's one thing to consider, given the amount of time we're going to need. It may be difficult to get anything done before March anyway, really, now that I think about the dates.
Fast. It's going by quickly.
Because for a mid-February meeting, we'd already have to do the morning now, beginning of January.
Right, the first of the year.
Right, 4 weeks, and I don't think we're going to be ready in 4 weeks, are we? We'll be.
Well, we could just say, do you want us to do the police fire? It's going to cost around a nickel.
Right.
And just see what people say. Right. We don't have to give great information, whether they go for it or not.
Better information yields better results.
Well, that's why you got to come to meetings. Right. our last one's tomorrow. So
these are things to consider. Any comments from anybody who's in attendance? Anything else from anybody on the board? All right, well, police fire will be on our meeting next week as well. And we look forward once again to having everybody participating and joining with us in the discussion of that.
Can I just add one more thing? I'm amazed that this is such a contentious, and I'm throwing this out there to everybody in TV land or whatever. This has been such a contentious thing for the last, we won't go back 30 years, but at least the last 5 or 6 years. And there's nobody in the audience asking questions. It blows my mind. It really does. And to only have, I was surprised with the 45 people that showed up for the meeting. So I was happy with that because I expected only 20. But there should be hundreds of people.
Well, we're at almost at 100 after two meetings. It's 245s.
Yeah, 245s. I know, but, it's, again, I guess we'll wait till the last hour to voice your opinion, but I was hoping we'd get more of a response. Oh, well.
Anything more about police fire facilities at this point? Next item on the agenda under new business is the Elliott Street Bridge repair. That item, unfortunately, however, needs to be deferred until December 15th. There's bad driving conditions up north, and V-Trans officials were going to be here in person to describe the project and the support they're providing for us, but they're not here. So we'll have this item on the agenda on December 15th.
Anything else to be added?
Nope.
All right.
Can't we run your salt trucks now? Right.
So the next item on the agenda.
89 was bad.
Was really bad.
The next item on the agenda is the Better Back Roads grant from the going towards the Department of Public Works. Peter?
Yes, and this is a small grant, $4,000, one that we had before you earlier in the year for the approval of the application. We have been granted the funds, and it will provide an inventory and a pay for a process of inventorying, prioritizing, and developing a capital budget plan for road-related erosion problems affecting water quality. It'll also identify any permitting or right-of-way issues related to the projects that end up on that plan. We recommend your approval that we accept and appropriate the $4,000 from V-Trans for this purpose.
Anybody on the board have any questions? There's only three people at the table right now, so do we need to defer this vote?
I don't think so.
Anybody in attendance have any comments or questions about the Better Back Roads grant? Hearing none, we're ready for motion.
I move that we accept and appropriate a $4,000 Better Back Roads grant from V-Trans to inventory, prioritize, and develop a capital budget plan for road-related erosion problems affecting water quality and to identify any related permitting or right-of-way issues.
Any further discussion?
I may have to think about this.
Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 3-0. Next matter on the agenda is GS Precision, Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, Exit 1, Industrial Park Agreements. Peter and Patrick, I think that what I'll ask you to do is to speak separately to the tax stabilization agreement and then to the
other set of agreements, because I think those conceptually fall into different areas. So if you would just talk us through the tax stabilization agreements first, and then we'll move to the other ones.
Sure.
We'll take votes about the tax stabilization agreements before moving on to the other three.
I will provide a quick overview of the collected actions that are before you today, and then Patrick will provide the details, and we'll do it as you ask with those two first and then the others. So we're really happy to have arrived at the day when it is the town's turn to take actions related to the support that the town, BDCC, the state of Vermont, and others are providing to the retention and expansion of GS Precision here in Brattleboro. As you know from prior public communication around this issue, as well as the private sessions in which we've reviewed the various contractual provisions that the town would be agreeing to as our part of our role in this process. This has been a very intense joint effort now for 6 to 8 months, dating back to the springtime announcement that GSP was looking to expand. We're really pleased that they responded well to the interest and commitment that they saw from the state of Vermont and BDCC and the town. And together, all of these parties have worked hard to make sure that this deal is structured in a way that GS Precision can enthusiastically stay here in Brattleboro and increase its presence. They currently provide over 300 really high quality jobs and are looking through this expansion project to create at least 100 more. So it's an important project for our community, and the town has six separate actions that need to be taken. We'll deal first with the tax stabilization, where there's an opportunity for us to provide some tax relief on the incremental portion of the value at the site that relates to the new work that's going to be ongoing soon there. And then we'll deal with some other matters that involve a loan from the town, from the program income fund, and some other procedural matters that need to be addressed based on prior agreements between the town and BDCC related to the Exit 1 Industrial Park, which is the site of GS Precision. So I'll ask Patrick to address the details of the two tax stabilization agreements.
Sure. Peter, I just wanted to ask, did you mention the recent correspondence from Pat Moulton, Secretary Moulton?
Please.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, man, this is... So some recent correspondence from Secretary Moulton at the Agency of Commerce and Community Development. The town has been awarded a grant of $1 million to work with and provide support to the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation as they work with and support GS Precision in their new expansion efforts. So pretty exciting news. It's a fairly substantial grant for the town. It's great to have such a worthwhile project in which to support. So as Peter mentioned, there's a series of actions that the board is being asked to take as our role in this project. We'll start with the tax stabilization agreements. As the board will recall, this is a fairly complicated project that involves a number of players, namely GS Precision and the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, but also involves the creation of some new corporate entities, in this case, Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings Incorporated, which will be the taxpayer with respect to the tax stabilization agreements. And so after a thorough review of the application and of the project and grading it against the town plan and consideration of the job growth and increases to the grant list, staff is fully prepared to recommend the following terms of a tax stabilization agreement for the real estate taxes to be paid by Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings. That would be an agreement whereby the valuation of the improvements constructed in 2016 shall be fixed for a period of 10 years for the purpose of the municipal tax rate at 35% of fair market value. Those are the terms of the real estate tax stabilization agreement. Are there any specific questions about that agreement?
If you can just clarify specifically what does it mean, because the town of Brattleboro would otherwise be expecting to receive additional real estate tax revenue as a result of the expansion of this facility, and we're going to be cutting those taxes by two-thirds, essentially, on the increased tax revenue for this period of 10 years in order to support this business. I want to make sure that the precise terms are very clear.
Okay. In an effort to make it as simple as possible, let's say, for example, that the property was presently valued at $3 million. And over the course of this project, at the conclusion, the assessor evaluates the property and recognizes $2 million in additional improvements. So now we've got an assessment at $5 million. So for the period of the next 10 years, what the property taxpayer would pay would be their ordinary property taxes for that first $3 million. Nothing would change there. But for the improvements constructed here in 2016, we would set the value of that property at 35% of fair market value. So there will be an increase to the taxes received by the town over the duration of this agreement. It just wouldn't be 100% of the fair market value. And it's what the town is providing in consideration of the significant impacts that the project is going to have to our local and regional economy.
So it's 35% on the $2 million.
Correct. Right. Only on the improvements.
Only on the improvements.
And the property taxpayer will be paying 100% of the municipal property tax on the previous value.
Right.
And the $2 million is just hypothetical.
Right.
Correct. That is correct. Okay. The final value will be determined by the assessor post completion of the project.
And then, if you could talk about the business personal property tax stabilization as well.
Sure. Once again, the property taxpayer will be Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings, Inc. And the tax stabilization agreement here also applies only to the municipal tax assessment. And we are proposing to set the value of the new equipment, not the existing equipment involved in the project, but only the new purchased equipment, at 25% of fair market value for the period of 10 years. So, I believe at the present time, the estimated new equipment to be brought into this project is $4,775,000 worth of new manufacturing equipment that GS Precision will use to make the parts that they make and create the jobs that they will. What we are proposing is that we set the value of that property at 25% the purchase price for a period of 10 years and tax it accordingly. So their existing equipment that they're using, and there's a lot of it, will be taxed at the regular rate. The new equipment that they're using to generate these new employment positions will be taxed at a lower rate for a period of 10 years. The valuation of that business personal property will be set and fixed over the lifetime of this agreement.
Is that a common practice? I mean, is that common to establish that, you know, for new or for businesses like that? Just to
yes, and it's the as Patrick has described with the details of this particular case, the emphasis is on the new value, right, so that it never actually transfers a burden from existing taxpayers to the other existing taxpayers. But it takes, in a situation where an existing taxpayer is considering an expansion, like in this case, or where someone is looking at the possibility of building a new facility, it provides an incentive where that new investment in town that is going to grow our grand list and create greater long-term tax wherewithal for the community, that there is an incentive to make that investment here, just as GSP has now committed to do.
Anybody on the board have any questions or comments?
No, I think it's a good thing.
Well, yeah.
Anybody who's in attendance have any questions or comments about the tax stabilization agreements? I guess I would note that at last night's meeting and at the police fire facilities meeting 10 days ago, we heard comments about growing the grand list and about being business friendly. And we've had discussion here about the town's role in economic development and the steps that are being taken as part of this package really appear to be the best way in our current economy to be able to support business growth and growth of the grand list. I'm certainly in favor of supporting and proceeding this way. I will note that there is a certain level of tension in the municipality providing the tax incentives to the developer, because the benefit from the development really inures to the community as a whole, to the region as a whole, and that's why we've been talking about making regional economic development efforts, and it's one of the things that CEVEDS focuses on substantially. And we ask and we continue to hope that the state will broaden the tools that we have as a municipality to generate revenue so that we're not shifting burden of providing services for the entire region onto our residential taxpayers. We've begun that discussion at the Regional Economic Hub Committee, and we did reach out to the governor last year or the year before to talk about these issues. But we certainly hope that the state will consider providing us with other revenue generation mechanisms, even if it's something like allowing us to impose a small income tax, like a quarter of a percent income tax, in order to fund specific projects like a police fire facility that we have to construct in order to be able to support this level of economic activity here in town. Because without that, the burden on the local residential taxpayer really is very substantial, and we wind up being the supporter for the region's economy without being able to generate revenue except through residential real estate taxes, which actually are higher than our commercial real estate taxes here in Brattleboro, even though that wasn't the initial aim of the legislation. So we continue to work on that, and we hope that we can get some progress in that regard. Any other comments about these tax stabilization agreements? Dora?
Dora Bubalis, Brattleboro. Here's my concern. David, you just mentioned the fact that we're trying to shift the burden from the taxpayer, but the taxpayer will have the burden for 10 years. It doesn't benefit the taxpayer until the end of that 10 years. So the concern I have is that things like tax stabilization, community development funding, the kinds of things that we're talking about, the intention was never to use it for an existing highly profitable business. The intention was to give it to startups, to give it to new entities that don't have access to funding. I have a real concern because it's not just about this particular agreement, but when you do it with one entity, you don't have it to get to something else, because you have to look at your bottom line and you have to say, that's a nice idea, but I don't know if we can do that because we already have this agreement here. GS Precision is a really great company. They provide a lot of really good jobs. They've been good for the town. But it is a multi-million-dollar company that has access to its own funding. I have concerns about, this goes back to the sports team that says they're going to leave because nobody will build them a stadium. And I like that they're staying here. I like that the jobs are here. I have real concerns about using that much of what we have available for economic development for this use.
Thank you, Dora. Other questions or comments? Well, then we're ready for motions on the two tax stabilization agreements. Kate, want to do that?
I will.
Thank you.
I'm confident. I got to make sure I read the right one. Okay, the first one, I move that we approve the tax stabilization agreement between the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings, Inc., and the town of Brattleboro to provide 10 years of stabilization of the value of the new improvements at GS Precision's Exit 1 Industrial Park facilities at 35% of the fair market value for those new improvements. This agreement shall apply only to municipal tax assessment and not to the education property tax.
We have a motion to approve tax stabilization agreement as to real estate. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
The opposed or abstaining? It carries 4-0.
I move that we approve the business personal property tax stabilization agreement between the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings, Inc., and the town of Brattleboro to provide 10 years of stabilization of the value of new equipment to be installed at GS Precision's Exit 1 Industrial Park facilities at 25% of the original fair market value for that new equipment. This agreement shall apply only to municipal tax assessment and not to the education property tax.
We have a motion to provide tax stabilization on the business personal property tax. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. So, Patrick, I realized that when I asked you to provide separate presentations, that the loan portion is actually different from the other two items that then need to be addressed. So if you would talk with us now about the loan.
Sure.
Thank you.
As you'll recall, on September 1st, when the board authorized submission of the grant application to the Vermont Community Development Program, we also approved a $200,000 loan to GS Precision with terms to be determined. So the town, over the course of the last couple of months, has been working with the financing entities that are involved in the project, and in particular with the two other lending institutions, namely VEDA, the Vermont Economic Development Administration, and TD Bank. Together, the three of us formed the three lenders, with TD Bank in first position, lending somewhere in the neighborhood of $9 million. VEDA, I believe, roughly in the $2 million range in the town of Brattleboro at $200,000. Together, we are adopting the same terms, and the town is taking third position in terms of securing our loan funds. And the terms of the loan are 7 years with 3% interest. The first 18 months payments will be interest only, followed by regular payments with a balloon payment being the 66th payment of $97,439. So the town will receive its funds back in the entirety plus 3% at the conclusion of 7 years. We are securing the loan with a promissory note, a security agreement, and a UCC. And again, we are taking third position.
Any questions or comments from everybody on the board?
Can I just clarify that this money is not taxpayer dollars? It's actually money that's in the program income fund that we get back from community development block grant money?
Sure, absolutely. It is from our revolving loan fund, seeded with funds known as program income from past BCDB projects. So.
Right, and when Kate says not taxpayer money, it's not real estate tax dollars. It is money that was raised by the federal government, loaned here, repaid, or get granted here, loaned out, repaid, and then loaned back out. And I think Dora's comments about available funding apply as much or more to this money than to the tax stabilization. And we certainly heard those comments. Thank you.
But we still have, there's a lot left in that fund, right?
I think we were down to about $250,000 or $300,000, but money keeps getting replenished.
And then it keeps coming
in. Still, we have a couple hundred thousand.
It's about 300 right now.
300, right.
And above and beyond the 200 that would be lost.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the last financial report showed this money out of the fund.
Correct.
Any further comments or questions from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? We're ready for a motion on the loan.
Oh, okay, I'll do it. To approve a loan agreement between GS Precision and the town of Brattleboro for a $200,000 loan from the town's program income fund. The loan shall incur 3% interest and shall be repaid in 7 years in accordance with a repayment schedule that is set forth in an attachment to the agreement.
We have a motion to approve the $200,000 loan from program income. Yeah, 66 months.
Great.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. And then, Patrick, if you would talk about the last three actions together.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sure. A short history. Back in the early 80s, the town of Brattleboro and the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation partnered on a new project for the town and for the community, which was the Exit 1 Industrial Park. Once again, the town was acting as the municipal applicant to, in this case, a federal grant program called UDAG, or the Urban Development Action Grant. The town was able to secure $1.4 million to assist the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation in developing this parcel and having it permitted and having it become our area's first industrial park. Some years later, after 1984, I believe it was in 1996, the original intent was that Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation would repay the town the $1.4 million from the proceeds of the sale of the various lots at Exit 1. Lots sold probably a little slower than anticipated, and in 1996, the town and the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation came to a new agreement that provided loan forgiveness, but also provided the opportunity for the town to receive the net proceeds of sales of lots at the Exit 1 park, but it also enumerated certain costs that would be included in the calculation. And those costs included the carrying costs of certain parcels of land. Recently, and in association with this project, the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation notified the town of its intent to sell lots 2B, the pond lot, and the parking rights on lot 6. And consistent with our 1996 agreement, the Brattleboro Select Board is required to authorize those sales. And the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation is required to provide evidence of the allowable costs so as to demonstrate the existence or non-existence of net proceeds. After having reviewed their submission, it is clear there are no net proceeds due the town, and accordingly, we're asking the board to approve the sale of lots 2B, the pond lot, and the parking rights of lot 6. If that is approved, I'll sort of finish the package. If that is approved, then the next two recommendations will discharge the mortgages on those parcels and complete or allow the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation to proceed with utilizing these parcels for the project.
Thank you. Anybody on the board have any questions about this?
Can I just ask a clarifying question? The reason we are saying that that Brattleboro Development Credit Corp can sell the land to the Brattleboro Development Credit Corp real estate holding is because we were the original, whatever the word is, loan grantor of the one point, whatever it was, UDAG grant?
We were the original applicant, right. Received the funds, yeah. And turned around and loaned them to the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation. Mm-hmm. With there being a 1984 agreement for repayment. The repaid funds would have returned to our revolving loan fund, the source of the $200,000 loan. It became clear between the town and BDCC over the course of the next 12 years that that wasn't likely going to happen. And in consideration of all the growth that occurred there, the town provided loan forgiveness with the option for net proceeds. However, it's been 19 years since that second agreement, and the carrying costs associated with maintaining those parcels have made it such that there really isn't going to be any net proceeds. And so the recommendation is that you approve the sale, which would allow the project to move forward.
Because the reason I ask is somebody out there might be wondering, why is the town of Brattleboro saying BDCC can sell land? I mean, do you see what I mean?
It's sure, not like the it's town kind of unusual.
Yeah. So I just wanted to make sure that, because it sounds odd on the face of it.
Yeah. It's based on the terms of a 1996 agreement, which was included in the board package. It's on the website made available, and it positions the Brattleboro Select Board to approve the sale of these parcels.
And so to take a little bit more of a 30,000-foot view of the situation, federal money came into Brattleboro in the mid-1980s to help create the Exit 1 Industrial Park. And initially, the contracts contemplated that as the parcels were sold off, we as the town, because we had done the application and gotten the grant money, would have the authority to approve the sale, and we would be getting money back from the grant money, which would go into a revolving loan fund. And unfortunately, over the years, BDCC wasn't able to pay the money back into the town and into the revolving loan fund, and now the proceeds have essentially been eaten up by carrying costs. And so the land is there, but there's no money to go back into the town's revolving loan fund. So we have developed, to a large extent, Exit 1 Industrial Park, but we don't have additional money in the town's coffers to support revolving loans to support economic development.
So any of the lots that are up there that are left still have to go through us to get approved?
That's my understanding, but there's not likely to be any money coming those either.
Right.
Right. The net proceeds issue is come and gone, right, because of the passage of time. But the other aspect of That really relates to the two discharges of mortgage. The approval of the sale relates more to a check and balance on just making sure that the development of this site is proceeding in an appropriate manner, and it gave the select board an opportunity. In this instance, we're working on something where it's been very collaborative, and so it feels like it's it feels like it's just an automatic thing to do. Right. It begs the question of why is there even a procedural step where the select board would approve this? Well, if the circumstances were different and BDCC were pursuing something that they viewed as a good opportunity for the community and the development of that site, but for some reason the select board believed that it was not in the best interest of the community, or the sale price was too low, or there was some other aspect to this that gave you concern, you'd actually have a counterbalancing opportunity to intervene in that sale. So here, what we're saying is it's a good thing for the community, and right, it's all been appropriately structured, and we recommend that you approve the sale.
And then the discharges?
The discharges relate to,
there ain't no money,
the mortgage that still exists, but where the payment back on that mortgage relates to dispersal of net proceeds, and because of the passage of time, there's no net proceeds.
There is dispersal proceeds.
That's right.
Any other questions from anybody on the board? Any questions or comments from anybody who's in attendance? Well, then we're ready for three more motions, one at a time. Thanks.
I'll do the first one, sure. Approve the sale of Lot 2B, the pond lot, and parking rights on Lot 6 from the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation to Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation Real Estate Holdings, Inc.
Excellent. Any more questions about that approval of the sale? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We oppose retaining. That carries 4-0. Next.
Go ahead, Kate, and I'll do the last one.
Oh, I get to do the long one.
You're good at this.
I move that we authorize the town manager to execute a partial discharge of the mortgage from the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, recorded in the Brattleboro Land Records on November 7, 1984, at volume 181, page 148, and the mortgage from the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, recorded on November 6, 1992, at volume 231, page 664, for Lot 2B, the pond lot, and parking rights on Lot 6.
We have a motion to execute partial discharge on Lots 2B, the pond lot, and parking rights on Lot 6. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
And we oppose abstaining. That carries 4-0. Next motion.
I move we authorize the town manager to execute a particle discharge. I think that's supposed
partial.
To be partial. Yeah. Discharge of the mortgage from the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, recorded in the Brattleboro Land Records of July 9th, 1996. At volume 255, page 153, for parking rights on Lot 6.
We have another motion for partial discharge on parking rights on Lot 6. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
And we oppose or abstaining? That carries 4-0.
Just as a side note, in 1984, the town manager was Corwin L.L. So I just thought that was
the original agreement with
the original agreement.
For the park.
Well, it's we've been very pleased to be able to participate in a collaborative way with BDCC and with the state to keep GS Precision here and to facilitate expansion of their facility with good, high-paying quality jobs. And it's a solid step we're taking to support the local economy, particularly with the departure of VY. And we're glad to be able to do these approvals, and we look forward to working with GSB and BDCC a long time into the future.
When does the groundbreaking start? Anybody know?
Mm-hmm.
conditions. Thank you for your actions tonight. It's great.
Excellent.
Nice pleasure. Come again.
The next items on the agenda are going to be moved around a little bit because we're going to have a long item in solid waste, and it looks to me like there's a couple of shorter items that we can clear away quickly. So after errors and omissions to the grand list, we're going to hear about an act on ratification of the compressor and approval of the small and inspiring grant for the dog park, and then do the community drug and addiction program grant, and then turn to the solid waste matter. Russell, good to see you.
Good to see you.
How can we help tonight with the errors and omissions list?
This will allow us to finish up the grand list for the year, send the last version to the state. These are errors and omissions that were found after the grant list was printed in early July and the tax rate was set. And I'm glad to say that not only is the list short, but the result is a net plus.
Good work.
Well, if there's a detail that you're interested in, there are three pieces of real estate and the rest is all business personal property.
Everybody have a chance to look at the E&O list, and are there any questions? Did anybody in attendance have any questions about the errors and omissions to the grand list? Well, then we're ready for a motion.
I move we approve the correction of errors and omission on the Town of Brattleboro's 2015 grant list in accordance with the memorandum dated November 5th, 2015 from Town Assessor Russell Rice and the spreadsheet attached to that memorandum. Russell gets it right all the time.
We have a motion to approve the errors and omission list. Any further questions or discussion from anybody on the board? Anybody in attendance? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. Thanks, Russell.
Thank you.
The next matter on the agenda is to consider ratification of the town manager's approval of the emergency purchase of a replacement 100 horsepower compressor at the Nelson Withington Skating Rink.
Are you going to take this, or Carol can explain a little bit?
I'll go ahead and briefly describe it, and if you have any detailed questions, we'll ask Carol to address them. The backup material that Carol prepared identifies in detail a sequence of events that led to the complete failure of the 100 horsepower compressor at the rink. We have a 100 horsepower compressor and a 60 horsepower compressor that work together to keep the ice in good condition there. And when the 100 horsepower compressor failed and inspection was made of what had gone wrong there, it was clear that it was caused by some maintenance that had been improperly performed the day before the damage occurred. So we are seeking full reimbursement through the insurance folks up at Vermont League of Cities and Towns. They're working on our behalf to recover the costs of this, but in the meantime, we couldn't wait for that responsibility aspect of this to get resolved. We needed to replace the 100 as quickly as possible. We're obviously in the heart of the beginning of the heart of the skating season, both for hockey and for other purposes. So we moved as quickly as we could. The details of that are documented here. The purchase that I authorized was $15,891 expenditure for an installation of a new 100 horsepower compressor. And because we had to proceed with this on an emergency basis, because it exceeds my $10,000 normal purchasing authority, we're bringing it to you to explain what went on and ask for your ratification of my decision.
Anybody on the board have any questions?
No, we've been through this, so we know what's kind of going on with.
I guess I want to clarify two sets of issues. So first, the source of the money to pay for the new compressor, it's not real estate tax dollars, is it?
That's correct. There is a fund that accrues with payments that are made for every rental at the ice rink that provides for maintenance. The funds that accrue in that fund are used to maintain the facility. So this initial expense of this $15,000 plus was expended from that fund, not from tax dollars. And as I described, we hope to actually replenish that fund in full for the amount of this expense.
And so then the second clarification, when you said that the problem arose as a result of some maintenance
yes.
that had been done wrongly. It was maintenance by somebody else not employed by the town.
By a third party, which is why we're seeking for them to make the town whole. That's right. It was a contractual piece of work. The metaphor that's been used in describing the situation is like taking your car in for an oil change and then driving away from the oil change and having a severe problem with the engine, which requires replacement of the engine in the car. It was an unfortunate set of circumstances where something that was meant to be minor routine maintenance, through a contracted third party, led to this situation.
And then just to clarify, although John said something about we've been down this road before, there may be issues globally with how the skating rink operates. We went through some of that last year or the year before where we had to put money into it, but this would appear to be an isolated issue from a contractor's error.
Correct.
That's separate apart from any overall issues with the skating rink.
Completely unrelated to any broader issues related to these two compressors.
Those are the things I wanted to clarify. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance?
I move.
Oh, you want to do it?
Good. I move to ratify town manager's decision to authorize as an emergency purchase the expenditure of $15,891 from the Rink Maintenance Fund for replacement of the 100 horsepower compressor at the Nelson Withington Skating Rink.
There you go.
Any further discussion? We have a motion to ratify that purchase. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. And then we have a small and inspiring grant for a dog park. Peter, maybe you can explain that.
It's got to be the best name for a grant program ever. Maybe second to the tiny grant program for planning services. This is indeed a request for a $2,500 small and inspiring grant through the Vermont Community Foundation. The request comes from the organizers of the dog park planning effort in conjunction with the recreation department. And specifically what the $2,500 grant would pay for is the purchase and installation of the fencing that would go around the dog park if everything falls into place and the project proceeds. We recommend your approval.
Any discussion from anybody on the board or anybody who's in attendance? Mr. Knowles.
Yeah, Bill, I just want to know how close are we to approve the dog park? Are we getting close to it?
It's already all done.
It's all done? All right.
All approved.
All right, so we had an inquiry from Mr. Knowles about how close we are to approval for the dog park. And Mr. Scholes said we have our approvals. Is that correct, Carol?
Yes, all the approvals, permitting approvals as far as local. As far as all the local approvals go, at this point we've been approved. We're still, because this project is in conjunction with the skate park, we're in the process of working with the state of Vermont to amend our Act 250 permit so that both projects are in conjunction. This dog park group has, in addition to this money, they have raised over $1,000, so they're on their way to their $17,000 goal.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments? We're ready for motion.
Oh, I will. To approve an application for a $2,500 small and inspiring grant from the Vermont Community Foundation to pay for purchase and installation of fencing for the proposed dog park at Living Memorial Park.
Any further discussion? We have a motion for apply for a small and inspiring grant.
Small and inspiring.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0.
I'm inspired.
Thank you, Carol, for coming. So we'll also move up on the agenda the Community Drug Interdiction Program grant. Peter, you want to speak to that?
Sure. This is for funding for work that you have previously approved and through a federal grant process, and it's going to be continuing on now, funded by the state rather than by the federal government. Otherwise, same as you have previously reviewed and approved, and we recommend your approval of this $60,000 grant.
And that's
not an application that's already granted.
That's correct. This is accepting and appropriating a grant that has been offered to the town by the state of Vermont in order to, again, continue these services that were previously funded by the federal government.
Excellent. Any discussion? Ready for a motion?
I move we accept and appropriate a $60,000 community drug interdiction grant from the Vermont Department of Public Safety.
Any further discussion? We have a motion to approve the drug interdiction grant. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. So the next item on the agenda is generally relating to solid waste related issues. I think what I'll do is I'll start the discussion in order to lay the groundwork, and then ask Peter and Patrick to add to the extent you feel appropriate, and then we'll hear what everybody has to say about it. As I understand it, there are a number of sets of issues currently on the table, and we're looking at those issues tonight in connection with development of the town's budget and the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District budget, with the goal of trying to determine whether we can achieve any cost savings through the solid waste management services that we provide as town as a whole. So one area that we are looking at has to do with the potential of shifting from picking up trash that goes to the landfill every week to every other week. And as I understand it, and we can hear more about it, that contractual change with Triple T, our hauler, could save the town quite a bit of money annually, like $95,000 a year.
Correct.
And so we'll have some discussion about that tonight, because there are certainly issues that the public needs to be aware of if we're going from picking up trash every week to every other week. And so we'll talk about that some more. That's the first issue. Mm-hmm. The second question is probably a little more complicated, and has more moving parts, as far as I can tell. And that has to do with how we interact with the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District and our assessment that we pay to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District, and what happens to our recyclables. Because there has been question about whether we should continue with our dual stream recycling system using the materials recycling facility that's up at the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District on Old Ferry Road, whether we should divert our recyclables to have them hauled elsewhere, and then other questions about the town's votes with respect to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District budget, which is on for consideration, I understand, 9 days from now, 2 days after our next select board meeting. And I know that based upon the financials that I've had a chance to review, I have some significant questions about what's been presented to us by the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District. Some of these things are carryover questions from last year that haven't really been significantly and sufficiently addressed, at least to my satisfaction on behalf of the town. And so we're going to want to raise those questions as well to make sure that before we as a town are voting, are casting our 6 votes with respect to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District budget, we understand what we're being assessed and why, and we make sure that the services that are being provided are actually serving the town of Brattleboro. So that's what I think that we're here to talk about tonight. And I'm gonna start by asking Peter and Patrick and anybody else who should talk about the issue, mm-hmm, to talk about
going from every week to every other week trash pickup.
Sure. I'll speak to that initially. We believe there's a real opportunity here to make this change and achieve, as you pointed out, almost $100,000 worth of annual savings. It will be not completely seamless, but we believe relatively easy for the community to make this behavioral change that will be required in order for this to succeed, based on how well the community as a whole has responded to the challenges of pay-as-you-throw. So already, because of the requirements of the state act that steered us to pay-as-you-throw and the diversion of a significantly greater amount of our waste stream into composting and recycling, the what's in the garbage part of the waste stream now tends to be cleaner, mostly plastics, mostly not including foodstuffs that rot. So it has less potential to become smelly or a health hazard if it has to sit for an extra week on somebody's property before it goes out to the curb. And in addition to that, just based on the reduction in volume, substantial reduction in volume, you know, less of it is making its way to the curb as garbage. More of it is making its way to the curb as recycling and as compost. And so we think it's a real natural here. When we look at the budget challenges that the town faces and the necessity to reflect on whether or not we're willing to have any reductions in levels of service in any of the different areas where we provide municipal services in order to achieve savings and keep taxes down, this one is crying out for action because of the fact that the changes we've already participated in as a community in the implementation of pay-as-you-throw are leading us right towards this additional step in modifying how we do solid waste as a whole. And there's a very significant cost savings available of $96,000 plus estimated for making that change. So the downsides are that individuals will have to store their garbage for longer. We recognize that there are households in Brattleboro, whether it's those who have very small children and have diapers in their garbage, or others that just have limitations on their ability to store their solid waste, for whom this is going to present some level of difficulty. So we don't want to underplay this and say that there's no downside to it, but we do think that for the community as a whole, the $96,000 savings and the sort of natural logical progression of the paradigm shift in the handling of solid waste makes this a wise thing for the town to do, and we're recommending that this be approved. I know that based on the nature of this being further change in the solid waste system, that you'll want to hear from the community and give consideration to this and probably not act on it directly tonight. But Patrick and I would recommend to you that you do ultimately, when you've heard enough and considered it fully enough, implement this change or approve the implementation of this change and do so within the next month or so that the anticipated savings can be incorporated into the FY17 budget.
Can you clarify the shift from weekly to biweekly trash pickup?
Yes.
Would we still have pickup of other stuff weekly?
Yes. Thank you for pointing that out. So the technical term is putrescible waste for things that rot and actually can present both a an odor problem and a health issue for a community. The putrescibles are mainly in the compost waste stream now, with the town doing the curbside compost very successfully and in an even more significant way now that pay-as-you-throw has been implemented. And compost would continue to be collected at the curb every week. Likewise, the recyclables would continue to be collected at the curb every week, not because they pose a health hazard or create odors or other discomfort, but because the volume of recycling is up in the community and it would be more difficult for people to store their recyclables for 2 weeks at a time. So we think it's wise to continue on with weekly recycling. It's necessary to continue on with weekly composting collection. But again, for the reasons I cited earlier, we believe that there is an opportunity for us to switch to every other week garbage collection.
And have we done some data collection that would compare the volume of rubbish that's going into the landfill from Brattleboro from like a three-month period or four-month period last year and the year before to this year? And if so, maybe you'd like to speak to those numbers?
We have, and I, why do I feel like I'm in court? we have, and
it's a slow pitch.
If you'll permit me to actually pass the interrogation forward. Patrick has done the detailed work on this and prepared the chart, and while it is good, straightforward information, I think in case there's any flavor he'd like to add around it, be helpful if you would speak to it. Thank you.
In other words, he's throwing you under the bus.
I'm passing on the softball pitch.
The soft pitch and the hot potato.
There you go.
All at once.
Frankly, I think the two of you have done a fabulous job in introducing this. I would like to speak just a little bit about the pie chart and what it represents. I'd also like to point out that the cost-saving opportunity that we're discussing here, that is changing over to every other week trash collection, is independent of any decision the board makes with respect to the district or with recycling.
Right.
So that this is a standalone opportunity. So, included in the board package is a sheet with a couple of pie charts. And what these pie charts represent is a transition in the makeup of Brattleboro's waste stream. We have been collecting data for years now on the tonnages of rubbish collected curbside, the tonnages of recycling, both cans and bottles and paper and cardboard collected at the curbside, and for the last couple of years, collecting data on the tonnage of compostable material collected curbside. And if we average the data in the first 4 months of the year for the past 2 years, you see that represented on the pie chart on the lower half of your page. The reason we have those 2 years and those particular 2 years, or those are years for which there is complete data around compost collection, because that program is still relatively new. What you can see is a pie which is dominated by rubbish to the tune of some 862 tons. There is a reasonable level of recycling and a relatively modest compost program. The same 4 months are depicted in the waste stream of between July and October of this year, following the implementation of our new pay-as-you-throw program, which the citizens of Brattleboro did a fabulous job in implementing, and the results of which stand out when looking at the pie chart, in that rubbish, for example, which was 862 tons in the comparable period of the last couple of years, is now down to less than 400, some 387 tons. So what you can see is that our waste stream is changing, that the volume of rubbish is cut in half or a little better, that the volume of compostable material is doubled, and that recycling is up to a modest degree. So the waste stream is changing, and in acknowledgement of that, we think that there's an opportunity to work with our vendor and have discussed, you know, what that impact might be from a cost-saving standpoint. And I think you mentioned it was $96,000 and change. And so we would recommend that as an opportunity that the board consider, recognizing that perhaps some public discussion around it for a little while in order to, you know, get used to the idea and make sure everybody understands and is accepting of it. But, you know, ultimately we would recommend this opportunity, having worked with you folks for several years through the last several budgets and in watching several years of budgets prior to that, the opportunity for a roughly $100,000 cost savings doesn't come along very often. And so we think it's something to consider.
Question about the chart. Go for it. Yeah.
The Patrick, the average for the average for 13 and 14, the total there is 1,250 tons. And for this year, the total is 875. There's like 350 ton difference. How do you account for that?
You know, I can't account for it specifically, but I can account for it somewhat anecdotally. We thought that was an interesting transition. And so one of the ways in which we tried to assess what's going on there is by talking to some of the haulers that operate in the area, and found several which indicated that their commercial clientele are up, indicating the possibility that there have been folks in town that have been making use of our curbside program, perhaps illegally, perhaps inappropriately, but are today seeking to have their, seeking instead of buying into the $2 and $3 bags, are seeking to establish commercial contracts with local haulers. The second thing, and perhaps more important than that, I spoke with Steve Lasauskas, who's the gentleman we've been working with at Waste Zero, the gentleman who facilitated and worked with us to develop our pay-as-you-throw program, who has overseen this type of transition in hundreds of communities nationwide. And what he says is that this this type of change, this type of drop in the overall waste stream, is exactly consistent with his experience nationwide. And so while we can't necessarily put a finger on where the reduction is going, we anticipate that some of it is going into commercial contracts that some of the regional haulers are enjoying, I'm sure. We think some of it may be purchasing decisions on the part of the public. And beyond that, we're really not clear. The only other thing we could offer is that we really haven't had the problems with illegal dumping that some had feared. Right. There have been handful of citations for illegal dumping, but really the reports aren't in there. We hear from the public pretty regularly. If there's garbage sitting on the road, we'll find out about it within an hour. And we're not hearing about it, we're not finding it, we're not issuing tickets. So can't tell you exactly where the reduction is going, but can tell you where it's not going.
Can I quiz the audience too?
Go for it.
Have the roll-off containers have more trash in them now? The recycling, the Fairground Road containers, are they pretty much the same quality of?
Yeah, Bob Spencer, Wyndham Solid Waste. Yes, we have had some increase in trash at Fairground Road. We have the district installed two security cameras on behalf of the town, and there have been a couple instances that there was obvious trash and the guilty parties were cited and fined, I believe.
$500.
Yes, yep. So that has one outlet. I also believe, and we found this in Vernon when we started pay-as-you-throw. I live in Vernon too. In 2014, we believe there were quite a few families that were letting their relatives and friends bring in trash bags from other communities where there's already pay-as-you-throw, whether it's Hinsdale or Northfield or. And, you know, there were driveways with 30 bags and two people living there, and that's gone away. So that may be part of it. But overall, we've had a great experience with pay-as-you-throw in Brattleboro and Vernon.
Other questions from the board?
Maybe we've had some discussion about the timing of when we would make a decision on going from weekly to bi-weekly collection, and I'd like to ask Kate maybe to speak to that a little bit, if you're prepared to do so.
Yeah, because we have just shifted people over to pay-as-you-throw, I think it's important that we make sure people are comfortable with the every other week. I agree. I think it's the right way to go, just from my own thinking about it. I do really think it's important, since we haven't just sprung pay-as-you-throw on. It seems like we just did it, but it's been going on for a couple of months. Mm-hmm. That we really give people the opportunity to think about it and be comfortable with it. The success that we've had with pay-as-you-throw would lead me to believe we're going to have success with this, but it's a change for people.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we were talking, if we did it, would it start in April or would it start in June? Or
right.
But we have to make the decision to do this soon.
Correct. If it's going to be a positive impact for the FY17 budget, we need to decide soon. The actual implementation could be in the spring, or we could wait for the beginning of the fiscal year, or we could pick some other time that, you know, whatever the board might determine to be the most opportune time.
So in deference to those considerations, which are really important, we'll put this matter back on a budget, back on the agenda, particularly with respect to the bi-weekly trash pickup on the 15th of December. All right? I see you, George, one second. I know that we probably will have when the Solid Waste Management District back on the budget next week, because there's some other information we need. But let's leave this discussion for 2 weeks out. And hopefully when the press explains what's going on, we are talking about going to trash pickup every other week. We want to hear if people have concerns about that.
And
on the 15th
of
December.
It's only trash, not compost recycling.
Correct.
Dora, please.
Dora Bubalis, Brattleboro. Just a thought. The town manager mentioned the issues with some people with storage and things like dirty diapers. And while a lot of the food waste has been taken care of by the compost, and most people seem to be taking advantage of that, not everybody, one of the things I've noticed is that people, because of the issue with needing to show the bags, less people are using trash cans when they put their things out on the curb. I also have noticed that the raccoons and the skunks can very easily rip through those bags, and I've seen some really shredded bags with trash all over the place on the street. And if we're going to go to every other week and people are storing those, the idea of trying to figure out how to make it, you know, how to help people make it less penetrable to rodents might be something to think about.
Sure.
Maybe providing some sort of like we did with the compost bin, some sort of town trash can that can't be opened or something like that. I don't, you know, but it's just something to think about, because I do think that those bags are pretty they're pretty thin.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I certainly have noticed, and I'm sure other people have seen the shredded bags on the street.
Can I just ask? Oh,
go,
you can go first.
No, please, you go. Okay.
Well, we don't, and maybe this is not what Dora meant, but people can still put their trash in a trash can. Like,
right.
They don't need to see your purple or.
Yeah, that's exactly what I wanted to speak to, too.
Because I put mine in a trash can, and they still come and get it.
Right, so I've done it both ways, and I've experienced it one time when I put just the bag out, exactly what you described. Some critter had fun with it the night before the pickup. I've seen that evidence of that around town also. We could make, as part of a continuing public education campaign around all of these issues, encouraging people to put the bags out in cans, because as long as your garbage is in a purple or a yellow bag, you know, the fact that you bring it to the curb in a can isn't going to create any kind of a problem for collection.
Just as a follow-up, our ordinance does require landlords to provide receptacles. We're not necessarily enforcing that. Certainly there are a lot of places where what our ordinance says is that each individual unit is supposed to have a trash can available for them to use, or some sort of container. So that's not necessarily happening. And a lot of times the trash cans are open and they don't have covers. And, you know, so it's just part of the ongoing issue if we're going to have the storage issue of,
right,
you know, every other week.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Any other discussion about the chain?
Jane Southworth, Brattleboro. Two things. I'm not a fan of meetings, but perhaps in terms of planning for the advent of what seems to be going to happen, the committee, Solid Waste Committee, ought to get reconstituted. And Moss Kaler has done a fabulous job of sending us off on pay-as-you-throw, and I think he could do an equally fabulous job on the education. And I think Norm and his guys do a very wonderful job picking up the trash and making sure that it's clean and and paying attention to what needs to be paid attention to. The thing that I do wonder about is there are people who are not currently composting, and the addition of that may raise other costs that will have to be dealt with if more people start composting. So.
Yep. That was kind of the, Jan, I'm glad you brought that up, because that was the point I was going to make. That I think, because I was kind of on the fence about composting in the beginning, but it's fantastic. It's amazing how much it takes out of, and I can't emphasize that enough, as being a naysayer in the beginning, that if you're thinking about composting, do it, because it's amazing how much weight and is taken out of your trash. It's just fantastic. So,
well, we'll continue and encourage people to join up in the composting program.
Yeah,
it makes
it
a very, very big difference. Sure, Bob.
I went with Moss in September to weigh bags, that set out bags to compare how much compost is put out, how much trash, and recyclables. And at your house, John,
I know you weighed it.
Had 13 pounds.
Thank you.
Of organics and about 6 pounds of trash. And I said, John's doing a great job. So, but what I did want to point out is that
a lot of good food.
And I checked with Moss, and about 1,800 residents units in Brattleboro are now participating in the curbside program. We don't really know, there hasn't been a count, but based on up from around 1,000 from prior to pay as you throw. And I believe there's about 3,000 households in the collection, is that right, Peter? Something. So maybe 45% of the eligible residents households are participating. So having an increased education to get those others, and obviously we have the composting facility and space in at our site in on Old Ferry Road, so that would should just be part of the program.
Isn't it closer to 4,000?
I think it is. Yeah. The households in
4,000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, that's how 1,800 is about 45% of 4,000.
Thank
you. No, that's perfect.
So there's a great deal of additional improvement that we could do there in terms of participation. And
mm-hmm. It just really works.
Great. So we'll have this reduction in the frequency of garbage pickup on the agenda in 2 weeks. So now transitioning over to issues relating to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District. Peter, sure. Go ahead.
So we had two recommendations in the materials that are in the notebooks and on the online related to interrelated recommendations. One that related to the transition of our recycling program to a single stream recycling program, where it would still be collected at the curb by Triple T, but then Triple T would do the transporting to a Rutland facility for the disposal of that material, processing of it, rather than as is done now with our dual stream, transporting it to the solid waste district and to the local MRF as one component of this. And then a related component, taking that piece of potential transition in our solid waste program and the one we've just discussed of switching to every other week, and reworking the contract with Triple T, where there'd be a potential contract extension and some change of terms in order to have the town achieve the savings that we believe are available, some of which we've just talked about and some of which would be related to this recycling transition. That got published on last Wednesday, the day before the long holiday weekend. We've had a lot of interaction in the last two business days with various individuals who both in some cases have a strong opinion about this and in other cases had some additional data to share. The most important piece of additional data that we received was learning from the Solid Waste District that there actually was a an updated no MRF budget, and I'll explain in a second what I mean by that. But in the backup materials, the last page of town backup materials, just in front of the letter from the Solid Waste District and the proposed budget from the district, there's a chart there that estimated under four different scenarios what the savings to the town might be depending on what choices we made and what we implemented for changes going forward. The no MRF budget alternative that appears in two of those four columns is reflective of the consideration that the board at the Solid Waste District has given to closing down the recycling processing operation at the district facilities and operating the other aspects of the district without what's called a MRF, a materials recovery facility. So they for a while in their budgetary process, and the two select board members who participate representing the town there who may want to speak to discussions that were had over the last several weeks regarding this, but I can say that in the course of preparing the budget and reviewing the budget at the district, there has been a time when they were looking both at a proposed status quo continuation of service budget alongside a no MRF budget that would involve the closure of the recycling facility there. The savings based on the last no MRF budget that we had seen, which was one dated November 10th, is what is reflected in the backup materials for this meeting. We've learned today that there actually was an update to that prepared on November 12th that had reflected some increased cost in the operation of the district, therefore some increased assessment to the participating municipalities. And because of that increased assessment, the impact of that increased assessment reduced the estimated savings that we had previously reflected in the materials we had given to you. So significantly reduced those savings that it now looks unfavorable to change the town's method of recycling and processing of recycling. To where it's actually about a wash. It appears to be savings under either scenario, whether there would be a no MRF budget or a status quo budget, but certainly not substantial savings to be had under the current data. And so the recommendation that's in your backup related to the town potentially taking a position that we would utilize our six votes and recommend to other of our municipal partners at the district that we have the district approve a no MRF budget and achieve those savings and go through the transition that we had described in these materials now appears to be at least less desirable, perhaps undesirable. This is late breaking news, and we think that it warrants some additional examination, some additional interaction with the district to understand better the difference between the November 10th budget and the November 12th budget. And you know, if the board would like, we can certainly pursue that, defer this matter and pursue that to come back. I think it would put you in a better position to make decisions going forward if you had more complete verified information in front of you. If you were to proceed tonight, our recommendation would change. And we would no longer be recommending the change to single stream recycling.
Thank you. Is there anything, Patrick, do you want to add right now?
Not right now.
So I'm going to speak to that if I could, because there's two sets of issues that I'm interested in understanding and hearing about. Coming into tonight's meeting until 5:30 today, I understood that the question for the board to decide is whether we wanted to continue with a dual stream recycling and sending our recycling to the materials recovery facility on Old Ferry Road at the Windham Solid Waste Management District, or whether we wanted to save, at least initially by what we understood, about $20,000 a year,
right,
approximately, by doing single stream recycling so that metal and glass and paper could all be commingled, and then not sending that to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District, but instead sending that through Triple T up to Rutland. And that seemed to be a interesting question. There were some issues that needed to be addressed. Is it better to go dual stream or single stream? And would the savings be long-term or would they be illusory? Because the money we have to pay for tipping recyclables right now in Rutland is low, but apparently it could go way higher. But the information that was handed to us at the very last minute totally scuttled our ability to do that analysis. And so the first inquiry I have is posed to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District. There is a no materials recovery facility budget with which the town of Brattleboro was presented, dated November 10, 2015, which showed our assessment at $105,814,000. And then there's a budget 2 days later showing our assessment at $123,366,000, an increase of $18,000, two days later with no explanation. And I don't have any way to understand why it is that Wyndham Solid Waste Management District in 2 days changed its assessment for a no materials recovery facility budget by increasing our assessment by $17,500. And we've asked the town manager to get that information for us so that we can understand it before next week's meeting. All right, you can provide whatever explanation you can now, but we want those numbers reviewed and verified by our administration so that we can understand them at the town level. That's one question that I have. The second question I have goes back to the material, the recycling collection program, of which I understand that we're paying $48,998, almost $50,000 a year for recycling collection program. The town of Brattleboro pays through its hauler to collect recycling from everybody who qualifies to have collection. And as I understand it, Vermont law shifted last year to require commercial haulers to provide recycling collection. So all of Brattleboro's recycling material should be covered for collection either through our municipally paid for program or through commercial haulers that service the community. And I want to understand why the town of Brattleboro should be paying $50,000 a year to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District for a recycling collection program that I don't believe serves the interests of the town of Brattleboro at all. And I've asked the town manager to work with the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District to understand why we should be paying this $50,000 to the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District to collect recyclables when we're already paying for it out of the budget. It's exactly the question I asked last year. I never got an answer last year. And this year, I'm going to recommend next week that we vote against the budget unless that's taken out, because we shouldn't be paying that. And we think that it should be a fee-for-service approach or some other approach. But we shouldn't be double-billed. And you took issue with us last year when we characterized it as being double-billed. But it certainly appears to me to be double billing. We're asking our residential taxpayers to pay for recycling in their tax dollars, and then commercial haulers are supposed to be paying for recycling as well, or providing recycling services. So why are we paying for this separately? Please explain that to me. That's my question. And we need those answers before next Tuesday so that we can vote. And if you can't give the answers today, we're going to ask you please to work with the town manager so that we can give instructions to our representatives about how they should vote on the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District budget. It's got to serve our interests as well. We're a member town.
Okay, I'm Lou Brusso. I'm chair of the Board of Supervisors, and I'm also the representative from the town of Jamaica to the Board of Supervisors. Jamaica is a transfer station town, which is a little bit different than some of our other towns, so we'll be talking a little bit about that. First of all, I'd like to point out that David will tell you that I've been an advocate for single stream for quite a long time. I've come to the impression that I think you can increase recycling because more material can be recycled, and it makes it a lot easier for people, and that's philosophically, I think, the reason why I'm a supporter of single stream. The other approach that I would like to talk about is the fact that our recycling program started back in the mid-90s when there was no recycling in this area. And it was a very necessary program, and I think it's really served the community well. Up until Act 148, private haulers did not pick up recycling at homes, so we were the alternative to that, as you just mentioned, David. I think the fact that there now is a private sector handling that is crucial as helping to weigh. However, what you've seen is that there's a cost for that. Right now, that cost is about $50 a ton. So any savings that would be accrued from the $60,000 you were talking about would be somewhat eroded because of the cost of having to ship that up to Rutland. I think looking at the numbers was about $42,500 approximately. So that $60,000 you were talking about saving was eaten up partially by that. The other part of that $60,000 that you're talking about is the fact that we've sharpened our pencil at the district. We've laid off a few people. We've created a more realistic budget, we think. We've decreased the revenues, but we've also decreased our staff. We've also let go a couple of part-time people. I'm a little bit skeptical of those numbers, as those of us on the Finance Committee will know. I think our revenue numbers are a little bit high. However, I support the dual stream budget because the fact that I think the budget decrease is around 11%, around 11.5%. So that $60,000 that you were talking about is decreased by about 11.5%, which narrows that margin between $60,000 and $42,500. However, there's a few things I'd like to point out to you that I think you should be keeping an eye on in the next year. Number one is 2 years ago, we lost approximately $35,000 or so at the district in our annual operation. Last year, we lost about $105,000. That number was covered by surplus revenues we've had during the good times. Well, right now, those surplus revenues are gone, and our net asset value at the end of June was about $35,000. So what the number you should be looking at is, during the course of this year, what is our loss or our gain, and what our net asset value is at the end of that time. We've changed our operation at the MRF right now to operate on 2016 budget numbers, not 2015 budget numbers. And what I mean by that is we've reduced our operation at the MRF, and we're going to see if we can actually operate at the level we're proposing. If you remember, I told you we reduced our budget by 11.5%. We're going to see during the next year whether we can actually operate at those levels or not. If it turns out at the end of this year that we can't operate at those levels, then I would say that we should be taking a hard look at whether we go to single stream, not waiting for 2017 budget, but actually doing it in the 2016 budget. So those are the things that I would encourage you and David as your rep and John as your alternate to be looking at during the course of the next year to see if we can actually operate at the expense level that we're talking about. Jan, I'd like you to speak, if you would, to the change in the budget between the no MRF, no trucking budget between the November 10th and the November 12th that that John was that David was talking about.
Jan, before you do, Lou, there are a couple things you didn't mention about the change of the operations there, the different handling of glass, the elimination of the non-recyclable plastics, and the additional materials from the HAMPS, for all of which are affecting the bottom line.
Regarding glass, that was one thing we did talk about, because glass is a not very profitable commodity. We actually almost give it away. We only charge a loading fee for glass. So we had talked about removing glass from our operation. However, that would have saved us a lot of money. However, we found out from A&R that we can't do that because we're charged as part of Act 148 to divert glass. However, the recycling commodities 3 through 7, we have been collecting, and we've been collecting at a big loss. And part of the reason we do that is because we know it's better for the environment to divert these materials. However, there is no market for them. So what we've decided to do in order to cut our operations down is to let those 3 through 7s pass through, pick them up real quickly, and throw them off to rubbish. And what that does is it allows us not to have to stop the operation periodically to be able to remove those containers and send those off to the baler. So the 3 through 7s, even though we're going to continue to collect them, will not be diverted, but instead will be sent off to the waste stream. Is that the other? Was there another part?
The materials from New Hampshire.
Oh, the materials from New Hampshire. Okay. Part of the reason why the revenue numbers are a little bit better than we thought that they would be was because there was a MRF down in, I think it was Billerica, Mass, that closed. And the NRRA, who is a group that provides us services, has gotten one of those communities that was shipping their stuff to Billerica, is now going to be shipping it to our facility, and it's really clean stuff, which doesn't have to be processed. It can be sent right to the baler. So that's part of, and there's, I think there's a lot of ones and twos. There's no 3 through 7s in there at all. So that's part of the reason why our revenue numbers went up.
Can I ask a follow-up stupid question?
No more stupid questions.
The 3 through 7.
Anything to do about dump trucks?
Yeah, anything. The 3 through 7 that you're referring to, you're taking them out now because it's a dual stream system?
No. Okay. Dual stream includes all plastics. Plastics are ones and twos.
Yeah.
They're very precious. We sell them and we make a big, you know, that's our biggest moneymaker.
Right. But if you had a single stream, can the 3 through 7s be in the single stream system?
Yes, 3 through 7 can be in single stream as well. We don't know what Rutland does with 3 through 7s. They could be diverting them, or they could be throwing them out like we are, because the market is really poor for that commodity.
All right, I'm just trying to figure out if you're having to pick something out of a dual stream, why don't you? I don't understand.
Okay.
Well, I'm sort of confused, but you don't have to explain it. It seems to me a single stream would be the better way to go if you're sitting there picking stuff out that could be in a single stream system.
Yeah, we don't know what they're doing with it. Everybody has to sell that commodity.
Okay.
And 3s, 4s, and 5s, that commodity is not very profitable. There's no market for it. We lose a lot. It costs us probably one person a year to be able to handle that material, but we barely make any of that money back when we sell those bales out. I suspect that Rutland probably has the same problem, but we don't know for sure whether they divert those 3 through 7s or whether they actually bale them and send them out. So either way, either our MRF or the Rutland MRF will be taking 3 through 7s. It's just a matter of what we do with them afterwards.
And how much it costs us to do whatever that thing is with them.
Right. I mean, since you're diverting them and throwing them into the trash, we're paying for it as a part of the assessment.
Yeah, that's correct. You're paying for them as part of the fee we pay to Triple T when we bring those, that or to whomever. That's correct. But they're not very, it's not a significant number because they tend to be very lightweight, and we pay for them by the ton. So it's not a huge expense, but we do have to pay for them. As
but people are not supposed to be putting 3 through 7 in the recycling.
They can if they want.
But you pick them out.
We end up throwing them away.
That's but correct. If there was a single stream, they could put them in.
They can still put them in, whether it goes.
Some people are going yes, and some people are going no.
I think to answer your question, Kate, a single stream, they're picking them out. Whether or not they have a market for them and they're doing something with them is a whole nother story. Yeah. But single stream is the whole point of single stream is to have it all go together, right, and then they pick it apart.
I'm just trying to figure out from a town level and from a taxpayer level, I get all this whatever, but to me, and I think it's what David said, it's the bottom line for us. Mm-hmm. And I'm sort of getting confused on why we're doing something if it costs more when we could do it a different way when it's cheaper. And I know it's a bigger issue, and I think for me, what I need to see, and it's great that you're giving this explanation verbally, but I can't make a decision until I see it on a piece of paper. So I appreciate the verbal explanation, but for me, it doesn't substitute for it being on paper. Because... Yep. You know.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think
just quickly, and this may be what you're going to say, but the cheapest thing would be if people just put it in a garbage bag.
Right.
That would definitely be the cheapest thing. The thinking was that if we collect it all and just say we recycle plastics, put them in the bin,
right,
that people would throw in a lot more ones and twos as well,
yeah,
and that would make it worthwhile. It turns out that hasn't actually proven to be true.
Right.
So that's the thinking about not processing them, yeah, and discouraging people from putting them in,
yeah,
the recycling.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, and there's another thing about 3 through 7s is right now the market is down. 2 or 3 years from now, the market could be back up.
Right.
We don't want to have to worry about changing people's behaviors, right, too many times. So by allowing 3 through 7s to still be recycled, sent to us, and even though we throw them away, 2 or 3 years from now, that market may pick up again, mm-hmm, and therefore we don't want to have to go back and say, okay, now you can do 3 through 7s again. So we're not, that's part of the reason why we're continuing to take it.
Right.
Any other questions for Luke?
That was
very helpful. Thank you. We had a comment over here before we switch over to Jen. Is that fair to say? Is it a comment or?
I know.
That's an old
idea. I tried to leave this alone, Norman Mallory. I tried to leave it alone, but I can't quite. When you throw something away, it's $100 a ton. So you're getting assessment money at $50 a ton to process, plus you pay $100 a ton to throw it away. So if somebody else is throwing it away and it doesn't cost you $100 a ton, that's kind of whether it's single stream or dual stream. In your case, you're not paying for it to be thrown away if you go single stream. If they stay dual stream, now you're paying for it to be thrown away because you belong to the district. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think, Jan, it's your turn. We started this before, too. Yeah.
That's okay. I'm very patient and flexible. I'm Jan Amin. I'm from Westminster. I'm the vice chair of the Solid Waste District. I'm also the executive director of the Franklin County Solid Waste District in Greenfield. So I have basically Bob's job in Western Massachusetts. As many of you know, budgets change constantly, and David and I and Lou and Bob have sat at probably 8 to 10 finance committee meetings for the Solid Waste District. We had a budget on the 10th of November that was brought to the finance committee for final tweaking before the board meeting on the 12th. We spent most of that finance committee meeting on the 12th refining the kind of status quo budget, which is the one that was proposed. We also spent some time tweaking the no MRF budget because we wanted, and Lou was very interested in having that option put out to the towns, even though it wasn't something that was going to be a proposed budget. So in that meeting, looking at the no MRF option, when we went through the numbers one more time, there were concerns that the number in there for maintenance of the MRF, even though it wouldn't be used, we would still have to heat it to make sure that the concrete floor didn't crack. We wanted to make sure that we were actually appropriating enough money for that expense. So that number, and I don't have the exact number with me, but that expense increased. At the same time, there was discussion about trying to save more money by reducing the hours of the convenience center. So we proposed reducing the hours of the convenience center by 20%. Well, if you're not open as frequently and people have another option, certainly to go to Triple T when our facility's closed, we decided to reduce our trash tip fees, our revenue from that center, by 20%. So between the 10th and the 12th, we, I think, did our due diligence and changed the numbers of the No MRF budget to more accurately represent what we thought with our crystal ball, like you'd going to be doing for your FY17 budget, what we thought would accurately represent having a no MRF and no hauling option. That budget was passed out. The no MRF option, that was changed. We our finance manager went right in, changed all the numbers, printed out copies for the board members, and that evening Mr. Allen was a supervisor and was handed a copy of that budget. The intention was that the supervisors would bring that revised 11-12 no MRF budget back to their towns, as well as towns would get a copy of the proposed budget. So I think it was just purely a situation of that new budget not getting to the town or not getting to Mr. Moreland until I emailed it to him yesterday or today. That's the difference between the $105,000 assessment, I think it was, in the 123.
Should have mailed it out.
So. We're just going to, ask that the specifics of the budget get reviewed so that we can understand the changes, because we certainly weren't prepared for that with today's meeting. And like I said, no MRF budget changed substantially in those 2 days, and we didn't have the updated information at least at the administration and select board level until today. And it, like I said, totally changes the questions that we have to look at today. And we can't make those decisions today without understanding the basis for the changes. So we've asked Peter and Patrick to follow up and to answer those questions, to get that data and to provide it to us.
That's perfectly reasonable, and I think any combination of us would be happy to sit down with Mr. Elwell and Mr. Moreland and discuss both budgets and the system that we're proposing and the alternatives.
Did you have something with that?
I wanted to update you on our process. Yeah. If you remember, last year we had this meeting around the end of January, or the end of December, early January. And what I pushed for this year is to have all of this accelerated by a month. And that's the reason why we're here on December 1st rather than on January 1st. The second thing is that our hearing, our budgetary hearing, is going to be on the 14th? What's the date? The 10th. December 10th at 6 o'clock. And what that means is that's a meeting open to the public and open to our select boards to give comment on our budget. And those comments can be given either directly at our meeting, or they can be given here at a select board meeting, or they could be sent to us by email or by letter. So I think you mentioned that you were thinking of discussing this again in a week. And that would be very timely, because that would be just before our hearing, and whatever comments that you had would be read into the minutes, or if one of you wanted to speak at our hearing, that would be put into our minutes directly. And then what would happen is our full board would then meet after that particular hearing, and then any comments that were made at that hearing could be discussed at the full board, and then that could cause us to amend our budget. So I think the timing is pretty good this year.
Thank you. Any other comments about this set of issues, Mr. Spencer?
Yeah, something that we discussed last year was, what is the value, and I think this board asked for, what is the value of being in Windham Solid Waste to the town of Brattleboro and other towns? And we don't have time to go over tonight, but I'll give you my summary of that, and we can discuss it at a further date. I brought a copy for each member. Oh, and also brought a magazine that I wrote an article for about Brattleboro and Vernon's pay-as-you-throw programs and its impacts on organics diversion. Because what we're doing here in Brattleboro and Windham County is very unique, truly unique in providing residential curbside collection. There's only a few communities doing that in the Northeast. And so there's a lot of interest in this program. We are having our, you know, growing pains. You know, there's a cost shift for all of these things. So I just wanted to kind of end on a high note. We have a really good working relationship with the staff, and Patrick and I and Peter and Norm, and we all work together on a staff level that all of you don't see. When Peter came on board, we met my office. And so we really are trying to be a good partner. And we'd love to work with you to work on these numbers. So thank you for this opportunity.
Well, I do have a follow-up question, though, okay? Because we've talked about the change from the 11-10 to the 11-12 budget and about trying to track that down. At this point, as I understand it, the budget that's being presented to us and the only budget would call for $147,229 assessment for the town of Brattleboro. And as I understand it from looking at the note at the bottom, that includes $48,098 for recycling collection program. And nobody has explained to me yet why my assessment for the town of Brattleboro isn't $98,000 or $99,000 instead of $150,000, and why we're paying for a recycling collection program. Why is the town of Brattleboro called upon to pay for that?
I think I tried to explain that. Is you said that your assessment would go from 138,000 to 90 something thousand, but also the cost of diverting your recyclables instead of sending them to us would go up another 42,500. So there's a corresponding.
It's the wrong. I'm asking about the recycling collection program. What is the recycling collection program budget?
Okay, the recycling collection program collects recyclables from the entire district, including at your Fairground Roads facility. That's crucial to us being able to operate the MRF. We can't operate the MRF unless we have materials. And if the recycling collection program went away, the MRF would have to go away as well.
But why should Brattleboro pay for collecting recyclables to the Solid Waste Management District? We already pay for it.
We pay them
to collect our recyclables.
That's
curbside.
Correct.
So why are we paying you?
But as I said, the collection program for the entire district supports the MRF operation.
I'm sorry, you're not answering my question. When we went through this last year, it was suggested that maybe I didn't understand the benefits of participation in the district. I totally understand. Jane explained it to me. I sort of understood it before. I understand it better now. But I still don't understand why the town of Brattleboro is being assessed $50,000 by the Solid Waste Management District for collection of recyclables when we already pay for it out of our municipal budget, and to the extent that our tax dollars don't pay for it, it's covered by commercial haulers. Why does your program properly assess the town of Brattleboro a fee other than you've got to pay for it?
Well, we did talk about fee for service. And what we concluded was that rather than charging all of our municipalities a fee for collecting these materials, the fee for service option would be the equivalent of the no MRF, no trucking option. If we went no MRF, no trucking, towns like Jamaica, which has transfer stations, would have to pay
for those recyclables on their own. And I think the impact to my town is about $3,000 extra if that were to happen. Wilmington, Dover, Wardsboro, their transfer station towns, they would also have to pay for their recyclables. So in essence, the fee for service is the equivalent of the no MRF, no trucking option. If we stick with the MRF, we have to stick with the transportation because it's the transportation which supplies the materials for the MRF. So when you look at the transportation, it has to be looked in conjunction with the MRF as being something that costs, as we said last year was $60,000. This year I think it's 11% less, so whatever that number translates into, about $50,000. And the equivalent of that is the additional fee that you would have to pay for transportation of that material to Rutland and processing that material in Rutland.
So then it still makes sense to have a no MRF.
Right.
I mean,
I'm confused.
I'm sorry. I heard your answer, but it didn't answer my question.
No, it didn't. And I understand your question, and I sent this information to Mr. Moreland today as well. And I confirm with Moss Kaler in just about 4 years ago, December of 2011, he did a survey of the people using the Fairground Roads collection containers. 75% of the individuals using those containers were Brattleboro residents who had access to the curbside program. Not businesses, not people from Vernon, not people from Guilford. Okay, so it's 4 years old. That means that people choose not to put their recyclables at the curb because who knows? They drive by Fairground Road, they don't want it to get wet, they like going there. Okay. That's 500 tons of recyclables, 75% of that. Now, those numbers have changed. I don't know. I suggested to Bob that we get an Antioch intern to stand out there and see what the new number is. How many people from Brattleboro with curbside are using that system? If it's 50%, that means that we're processing 250 tons of Brattleboro residential recyclables on our dime, which is your dime. So I think the reason why, whether that's worth $50,000 of hauling and processing, I don't know. I haven't crunched those numbers. I think really the question is, why do people from Brattleboro continue to use those containers when they can put their stuff out? So you are paying twice because your residents are split of where they're going.
So exactly right. We don't want to pay twice. We want those roll-ups.
Well, you're paying twice because we're serving your residents who are using those containers.
I'm sorry. We're here at the select board level.
Take it out.
We don't want the roll-ups at Fairground Road anymore. And we don't want to pay for them.
That's fine. Unfortunately,
and we want your program to change in order not to make us pay for them.
I understand that. Unfortunately, the way that our assessment works is based on population. It's not based on service. So I've had this conversation with Mr. Moreland. We could look at the hazardous waste day budget and say Brattleboro residents are using 80% of our hazardous waste day budget, but your town's only paying 40% or 60%. We don't do that at the Solid Waste District. We could look at every single program that we offer. School education. Brattleboro is using our program director 85% of the time, but you're only paying 60% of her time. Do we do that? We don't. If you want, we can try to back that out, but we didn't come to a fee-for-service program because it's very complicated to go from our population-based assessment to a fee-for-service program where we can say, Brattleboro, you're using 80% of this service. You're using 95% of the service, and we're going to charge you 95% of that cost. We don't do that, Mr. Gartenstein. I'm sorry. I'd like to see a new formula. I think we should do a formula based on population and property valuations. I think that would be fair.
Why can't you? I don't get it.
I don't
understand.
Why can't we? Because the budget is... That would be like saying somebody on... You know, Main Street used the fire department services, so we're going to charge. Or I never use in Westminster the ambulance service. Mm-hmm. I pay, my taxes pay, my 100% of my share for that ambulance service.
See, that's
it's the same.
Twice.
It's the same. You're not paying. You're not truly paying. I did say you're paying twice because you are. You're paying for the people who put their recycling out curbside, and you're paying for the people who put their recycling out at Fairground Road. Tell your residents not to use Fairground Road.
We take them away.
We want to take them away. We don't want those.
That's fine. So here's the other number that I gave to Mr. Moreland. If 75% of the tonnage is from Brattleboro residents, then your curbside tonnage is going to increase. You can't. It can't. Right. It's not going to disappear,
fine.
Folks.
We want it to go curbside.
You
We're
can.
For curbside.
You can. You're looking at 250 to 300 extra tons going into your curbside program. So you need to. Mr. Elwell needs to have that conversation with Triple T because
they're under a contract, right? You're under a contract, so it's not going to increase.
What do you mean it's not going to? If they have to pick up, if you're, I think Mr. Elwell understands my point, and we don't need to argue it this evening. Maybe he doesn't understand, but it seems like the best approach, I would suggest, is for us to have a conversation, and maybe you select board wants to have a meeting with us to understand that.
Yeah,
I think someday my solid waste district works on assessment and fee for service. It's a very big nut to separate those two, and I would appreciate your input in how to make that shift.
I think the best way to proceed is for us to communicate over the next day or two and get clearer on some of these issues and prepare a nice piece of backup for the board to review next week, and we can all come back together and have a conversation that is informed by some additional analysis rather than more freeform like this now. But one thing we're going to need to get clearer on in that communication we'll have over the next couple of days is why you view it as necessary to continue to have the roll-off location at Fairground Road and the collection program when it's not the same as some of the other examples that have been cited where a service is provided. That it's one thing to say that it's not a fee for service, it's based on the revenue is collected in a certain manner and then the programming is provided. That's absolutely true. So for instance, the example that you mentioned about the education, we know that it's true about the hazardous waste. There's certain other things like that, and I don't think you're hearing from anybody that the structure of the entire system is wrong. What you're hearing, I think, is that this particular piece of the program is duplicative. There's a provision of this service at Fairground Road that is already mm-hmm. offered through the curbside collection, and you're hearing from the select board that by whatever description, paying twice for it or whatever else, that doesn't make sense to us here in Brattleboro. So we need to understand better why you think it's an essential part of the program. And maybe when we understand that the answer to that better, we'll have a different conversation.
But I don't think, can I just say something? To me, the answer isn't are people put their trash in those roll-offs. That's not the answer, because we take those roll-offs away, they will put them in front of their house. So there has to be, in my opinion, a different answer than, 75% of your people 4 years ago put stuff in those roll-offs, because 4 years ago we didn't have the curbside mandatory recycling. It wasn't paid for. So to me, I just ask that when you talk about that, that's not the answer. At least that's not going to be an acceptable answer to me. It might be the answer, but it's not an acceptable answer. Because there are taxpayers out there who, we hear it all the time. People can't afford their property tax and we need to have a lower budget. And somebody is paying as opposed to $1 to get rid of their piece of paper. They're paying $2. And I think this is what it comes down to. And I'm sorry, I don't mean to get all upset about it.
No.
It's aggravating.
Well, I'm going to, John, you ready? You want to say something? There's people with their hands up, too.
Oh, so I know. Well, ready? I'll let her. You're ready?
You're ready?
Laura go, because she's had it up for a while.
Jane, go ahead.
Or Jane, or...
I think one of the issues is that the form of the assessment is the large issue in which we have to consider, because the assessments come from the difference between what it takes to run the district and the amount of money that the district has as revenue from all its services, and that is apportioned per capita, not per service. If we, so because Brattleboro has a has the highest population, it has the highest assessment. If, on the other hand, you change the form of either the district to fee for service, and our representatives requested that, that would be a significant change. Or there are other methods of raising money for solid waste districts, and I, at, in fear of getting whacked by certain interested parties, I suggest that we should consider a surcharge on trash, which 9 out of the 11 solid waste districts use. So I think that should be part of the discussion with the town manager. And God help me, I would like to volunteer to be part of that discussion if that's possible.
Dora.
I want to hear from you all too.
I just want to say that you are double paying for ambulance service because your insurance company also pays for whatever service happens. So there is a double payment there. Many things are also like that. So it isn't just this. I want to go back in a little history because the reason why the solid waste district formed in the first place was because Brattleboro as a town had a dump that it didn't want to have anything to do with. And it asked other towns to go in on a solid waste district that would then take responsibility for that dump so that Brattleboro didn't have to be responsible for it. The dump is still there. Brattleboro no longer has to be responsible for it, but Brattleboro, as with all of these other towns, and I would guess that probably 90% of the trash that is in that landfill now came from Brattleboro, not from the outer towns. So we have a responsibility as a town to work as a community with all of these other communities. Was it 19 towns? 19 towns. That all pay based on population, some of which are services they don't necessarily utilize. There are other ways to do it, and I think there are some serious issues with the district, as have been brought up here, trying to figure out how to make it financially feasible and to figure out whether it is financially feasible to run as an operation. The best way to save money as a community actually is to not produce the recycling at all. That's the best way to save money. And there are things that the town can do and that the state can do to incentivize not producing that. Like, for one thing, I believe, and I've said it for several years now, that the town should pass an ordinance requiring that all takeout containers produced in this town are compostable. Forget recycling, because most of that recycling is 3 through 7s. It's not 1s and 2s. For takeout containers. That's a thing we can do as a town. And that makes a huge difference in figuring out how to do that. That's just one. I believe there's economic development opportunities for figuring out how to deal with trash right here in this community rather than sending it out. The issue of the single stream versus dual stream. Single stream is not clean. And there are issues because right now, the facility in Rutland is in desperate need of materials. And so they may be offering a certain price, but eventually they're going to be the only game in town, and that's going to go up. So you're not necessarily saving money. So the idea is to not have to send it there at all. It just makes sense that way, and not produce the plastic. For every action, there is a reaction. So, and I have to say that when I served on the Windham Solid Waste board as the alternate for several years, I had no idea until I started serving on that board how much the other towns dislike Brattleboro. Dislike, immensely, immensely dislike Brattleboro. And because Brattleboro always was trying to wield this whole 6-vote thing over everything that happened at the district, So it didn't, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a communal thing. It's my understanding that it was a big deal to bring all of these towns together. They're very disparate towns with very, very different political, philosophical, structural facilities. And yet they were able to come together and make this district. So instead of getting, I know people are upset because they're looking for numbers. I know when I was serving on the board and I was going to the meetings, I haven't gone to the meetings recently, so I'm not familiar with the most recent numbers, but we were constantly trying to change the numbers to try to reduce the assessments because people didn't want to see the assessments go up. As far as the Fairground Road thing goes, I, as a resident, use it all the time. I want it there. Many residents feel the same way. We use it all the time, regardless of whether we have curbside. There are also plenty of people who don't get curbside, who also don't get service provided by whatever landlord they have to pick up their trash, to do their recycling. People go there all the time. Part of the whole communal aspect is that I, as a Brattleboro resident, can go over to Jamaica and dump my recyclables. Jamaica can come over here and dump their recyclables. Guilford can come over here and dump their recyclables. Marlboro, we can go to Marlboro. That's part of the whole thing. Everybody in? All together. That's how it works.
John, you had your hand up there.
The microphone will help.
Guilford has no boxes at all and uses Brattleboro's, and even Vernon uses Brattleboro's, and a lot of commercial businesses use Brattleboro's. So Brattleboro is paying through the nose for the boxes. And we're under contract, so if there's more stuff at the curb, then we're to pick it up. And if you stay dual stream, the district gets it anyways, and it'll be cleaner.
John.
So, I know that we're trying to be, and you know, Dora, we're going to disagree until hell freezes over. So, so other than being a good neighbor, I still don't know why we have the district. I'm always perplexed at that, you know. And if you can enlighten me, Jane. No, I would love to.
Historically, there was a dump, and the sharing of the dump was an initiating factor. In the 1980s, the Act 78 was passed, which said towns are responsible for garbage, and it's a good thing if towns join in districts. And so that was pushed. And so around the initial group of dump towns, it began to make more sense to do all the things that Act 78 required together, as opposed to each town writing its own required solid waste plan and doing recycling, hazardous waste education as required by the state. So to share the, and at the time we did have a landfill, which was a good thing and which was a money maker, and so the use of the landfill was taken up by the other towns. And so the landfill was one of the draws, and the requirements of Act 78, the then Act 148, could be carried out not by each town, but if you belong to a district, they did it and you didn't have to. So it was advantageous in a number of ways, and the districts were chartered, and then they became entities in their own, and so that creates a certain tension of governance, and Dora's right, they're you know, in the incipient development of the town, of the district, the big town, small town issues surfaced and continue to surface. But the district was there for convenience and you know, so that everybody didn't have to do what the law required. Somebody else would do it for them.
Right. But in the intervening years, now it's 2015, things have changed dramatically.
So we have a legal entity called the district that if we change, we then have to dissolve legally, and yep. That's an option.
Yep.
But up heretofore, it hasn't taken form.
Right.
Any other comments? Well, the board's waiting for some information so it can make a decision at the meeting. This item will be back on the agenda on December 8th, and we will vote at that time on how to direct our representative to use our votes. And I think it's pretty clear that there's two sets of questions that we need answers to before then, so that we can make a decision on that issue. Thanks all for participating in this discussion. It was very enlightening and very helpful. So the next and last item on the agenda is committee appointments. We have application for a permanent member of development, well, not permanent, but a full-time member of the Development Review Board, an alternate member of the Development Review Board, and a member of the Traffic Safety Committee. So I move to appoint Catherine Turnus as member of the Development Review Board, to appoint Dave Whittle as alternate member of the Development Review Board, and Louise Zack as a member of the Traffic Safety Committee. Right. Are there any other nominations? Hearing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. And then I see that we're supposed to announce a vacancy on the ADA Advisory Committee. So this serves as our announcement that there's a vacancy on the ADA Advisory Committee.
And then if you complete the announcement for other committees with vacancies, we don't have to go through this every time.
You want me to announce all
yes.
of them now?
Yes, please.
My binder's a mess. Does somebody have a list for me?
I know.
Where is it? Under what tab?
My tabs are all mixed up.
Is it this tab? That's my application.
Correct.
Here,
can I grab it?
Wreck it right
there you
now.
Go. Thank you. So, there are openings on the Agriculture Advisory Board, ADA Advisory Committee, Arts Committee, Citizen Police Communications Committee, Conservation Commission, alternate on the Development Review Board, Energy Committee, Fence Viewers who have to be legal voters of the town, Honor Roll, Regional Economic Hub Study Group, Senior Solutions Advisory Council, and SEVCA Board. Please, if anybody's interested in serving on any of those committees, submit an application to the town manager secretary and we'll get you right on the agenda.
Is this going to be like reading meetings
yeah.
now? At the end of every meeting?
Hopefully not. Hopefully that will take care of it for a while.
All right.
Until we get another
vacancy.
Resignation.
Okay.
No one gets
I think
resolved.
That we're ready for a motion to adjourn.
So
we have a motion to adjourn. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed or abstaining? That carries 4-0. Thank you, people who are watching on TV. Thank you, everybody who was in attendance. Thank you, members of the press and BCTV operators. Thank you, ASL interpreters. We'll look forward to seeing you all tomorrow at 6 o'clock at Academy School
no,
Gym.
No,
at the BAMS multipurpose room. I'm sorry, at the BAMS multipurpose room. Good night.